What can make There's a miracle in this room with my name on it. There's a healing in this room, and it's here for me. Oh, there's a breakthrough in this room. It's got my name on it. So I'm gonna put a praise on it.
So I'm gonna put a brand. Well, good morning. Praise the Lord, everybody. What another beautiful day in the kingdom of God. It's the day the Lord has made. We're going to rejoice. We're going to be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let's go to the house of the Lord. I pray that you are of sound mind, healthy in all of your ways, spiritually healthy. Your soul is healthy. Your body is healthy. I just thank God for so much grace. It is the day that the Lord has made, the time that we're in, the season that we're in, all of the things that we're really in. And I'm certainly not talking about the obvious. There's a plan. There's a purpose. There's a reason for this time in our life, for this season. And make absolutely no mistake about it. The Lord is going to come out on top having his way. We're safe as long as we trust him. Try that again. We're safe as long as we trust him. And he's fixed it so right now we can't trace him. Or so some say. But he's too big to hide when you seek him. Do you hear that? No, that's if you seek him. That's if you like, Lord, okay, you're not in this, you're not doing that, you know. And when you can't find him, don't make up a myth about where he is. When you can't find him, keep looking. You know, when we were kids, you know, my childhood still speaks loudly to me. When we were kids, we played a game of hide and seek, okay? And the problem with hide and go seek is that when you're the littlest one and you have the shortest legs and you can't outrun nobody, see, because the tree or the lamp pole was the base, okay? And you count to 21, you're supposed to hide your head, and you count to 21, you're not supposed to peep, okay? You're supposed to cover your eyes, no cheating, okay? And everybody would go scatter, and you had to go find them, and when you found them, you had to run to the base. And if you got to the base before them, or you saw them, and you called it, there go Junebug, there go Lightning Head. You can tell I was in the hood, right? And so, and so, there they go, there they go. There go KK, there go Nene. That's him and his sister, Minister King. Y'all supposed to know about KK and Nene. And you run to the base and you tag the base before them, okay, then they were it. The problem right now is it seems like God is playing hide and go seek, and we're calling out the wrong names running to the base. You can't make up who he is not, because you can't seem to find him. Okay? You just can't do it. You have to seek ye the Lord while he may be found, and call on him while he's near. And I just want you to bear with me today. Today I have a word from the Lord for you. I think it's a tremendous word for the Lord. I think it speaks to the nature of God, the character of God, the timing of God. It speaks to the purpose of God, the plan of God. And having said all of that, if it speaks to all of that, it has to speak to you and to me, because we're in him. Okay, hear that. We're in him. I wish I had time to skip through the Bible like I've been for the last 3 or 4 days. I just wished I had time to skip from Genesis over to Chronicles, to Samuel, to Mark, to Colossians, to Hebrews 4, to Hebrews 7, to Revelations 20, to Revelations 12. I just wished I had time to skip and just share with you. I told my wife last night, my thoughts are just scattered all over the place. And I appreciate Brother Jamal so much. He blessed my life. He just sent me a little note, something that the Lord had spoke to him. And it really, really, really grounded me. Jamal, I love you. I appreciate you. It really, really set me. It set me in an uncomfortable place. I was already in an uncomfortable place, but I was uncomfortable in the uncomfortable place. And just something that brothers shared with me just made me comfortable in an uncomfortable place, because the Lord was sharing some things with me that I didn't know how to say or communicate. Not because I didn't understand what he was saying, but I didn't know who to say it to. As long as you're talking about what God's going to give somebody next, saints, guess what? You know, we're living in that season where you know, I see miracles, signs, and wonders. You know, and when God just decides that I really want you and I don't want to buy you. You know, who wants a wife that is never satisfied until you buy her something? I mean, you'll tolerate her, but you don't want her. Okay. You want somebody to love you for you. Who wants a husband that he doesn't appreciate you until there's some hot food on the table? Oh, you're the best wife in the world. What about on your rest days? Are you still the best wife? Who wants somebody that doesn't want you unless there's something in it for them? And so, you know, sometimes the Lord will put his foot down. And I want to talk about that a little bit today. And I don't want to get into the lesson. But the Lord made me comfortable in an uncomfortable place. And I began to continue to seek him. And then yesterday, I was so blessed. A brother I haven't spoken to, I saw him in Atlanta a couple years ago for Bishop Long's funeral. Bishop Long, my brother, I love him. Eddie Long was a friend of mine. And I thank God for him being in my life. He brought me so much joy and pleasure, and he did so many great things. And we shared so many just great times, the time God let him walk. And then at his home going, I saw this particular brother, and we vowed to stay in touch. But we wasn't really intentional about it. We meant well, but we wasn't intentional. We didn't intentionally pick the phone up and say, "Hey, man, how you doing?" And he just called me yesterday, and out of the clear blue sky, first he sent me a text. Excuse me. And when he sent the text, it was just so simple. It says, "Can you talk?" I text back. I said, "Yes." And then he called, and that was one of the best calls I got in a long time. And it was just sharing some things that he was doing. He said it was on his heart. And there's some global things going on, and that makes me feel so good. There's some global things going on among leadership, from the evangelical circles to the Pentecostal circles, and especially to the prophetic circles. And this brother's been a prophet in the kingdom of God. If I said his name, you would know. He's been a prophet for, gosh, 35, 40 years that I know of. Way back in North Carolina, and then globally, he's been everywhere at least four times. So he says, "Don," I said, "Man, how you doing?" And we was chatting, and there's a global, well, not global, but there's a, what do you call it, a consortium of great minds coming together. He says, "Listen, for whatever reason, man, I don't know how we overlook, but please, would you be a part of this so we could come together, create a think tank as to how to transition and transfer this much wealth of knowledge into the next generation. The church hasn't done so good at passing information on to the next generation. How do we pass on? How do we rightly divide God's word? How do we understand the scriptures and establish them in present truth? How do we make sense out of when there seems to be no sense or nonsense?" And I was glad to get an invitation to that. I'm just trying to echo on what Jamal said. Just stuff that seems like it's scattered all over is really not scattered. It's God's got a road for you. I feel like I'm rambling. I don't know. Is anybody listening? I don't know. But let me tell you just some housekeeping real quick. Just real quick. Did she say Tuesday? Tuesday, right? Yeah, Tuesday. I'm doing a presentation Tuesday. Just where we are, and when I say where we are, it's really a presentation on the psychological effect on the times. We're doing an awareness. Let me be formal. It's a mental health seminar, symposium, teaching. But you know me, I'm going to put my own spin on it. But it's about mental health. And so they want the clinical side of me to address some mental health issues in our county. And I'm honored to have that invitation to be a primary speaker on a mental health. And that's Tuesday at what time? At noon. So if you have time, there's more information. My wife will give it to you. And then on Wednesday, yeah, this is going to be good. Pastors' wives. In political waves. Okay, so our very own Lady Nakia, and then Lady Omarosa Newsom. Newman, gosh, boy, if her husband heard me say Newsom, he would get me, because that's my golf buddy down in Florida. Omarosa's gonna be on there, and then co-pastor Susie Owens is gonna be on that. And that's gonna be Wednesday at 11 a.m., sponsored by Lady Kim McKissick. Most of you don't know Kim, but you know her husband, Bishop Rudolph McKissick. You know, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he. I ain't supposed to say that. Rudy gonna get me for it. Rudy, if you watch it, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he. But can't nobody do it like him, and he's anointed when he do it, and that's when he's preaching. He's preached himself happy when he goes like that. And so anyway, Wednesday at 11 o'clock. The pastor's wives, that's going to be great. Get your Bibles. Let's go to God's Word. So don't forget Tuesday. And I think, what did she say? Noon? The mental health seminar, and then pastor's wives in political waves. Our own Lady Nakia, Omarosa Newman, and co-pastor Susie Owens. Okay. That's going to be good. And then, of course, hosted by Kim McKissick. She's a sweetheart too. Lady Kim, if you're watching, you know she has an affectionate name for me. When she talks to my wife, she said, "How's the Don doing?" I mean, she makes me feel like Don Corleone or something. "How's the Don?" She calls me all the time. Tell the Don I said hello. She's funny. Get your Bibles. Oh boy, Pastor feeling silly today. How are you? I'm doing good, doing good. Hey, were you blessed by the music this morning? Yeah, that's our very own, the sounds of our very own house. That young lady got an anointed future. She really does. We're thankful that God sent her to us so we can reap the benefits of that anointing for a long, 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 long time. Amen. Lady Jocelyn, we appreciate you. Amen. Keep praying. I know you're already praying about some new stuff. We haven't talked about it, but I know you're praying about some new stuff anyway. Pray on, lady, pray on. The Lord's going to bless your life. Turn your Bibles to 2 Samuel with me. 2 Samuel. This is where your pastor is stuck as it relates to the wars, the rumors of wars, the earthquakes in diverse places, political leadership, spiritual leadership, the time they were in, the economic times. The elections coming up, the benefits running out, churches closing, COVID on the rise. It is my hope, my prayer. It is my hope, it is my prayer that you remain diligent, that you beat back the spirit of anxiety for the house, for staying in the house. Don't go out. Don't stop washing your hands. Don't stop wearing your masks. Don't stop. There's a 155,000. You can quote the number with me because I don't understand the number. I don't know what 155,000 people that have died in the space of 3.5-4 months. I don't, that's bigger than my pay grade. I mean, I hear the number, but I have no idea what 150 some thousand families are going through. You take your loved one to the hospital for a cold, and then you hear 48 hours later that they're not with you anymore. And we have some on this line, on our platform this morning. Please don't take that lightly. Please don't take that lightly. We have some right now looking for answers, hoping the pastor can give them an answer to pour some oil over their wounds, because the wounds are fresh, they're deep, they're hard, they're painful, and we don't take this lightly. So we not. I don't have the message. If you tuned in today for the message that said, you know, when we come out of this, there's going to be a brand new Mercedes in everybody's garage. I don't have that message. If we come out of this, there's going to be a new house for everybody. I don't have that message. So if you tuned in for the bless me message, I don't have that. But if you tuned in for the Lord, how can we get closer to you? Can you reveal your plan, your purpose, your hand, your heart, your mind to us? I think that we're on the verges of that message. Okay, so if you tuned in, I come today to help those that are wounded. So go with me. 2 Samuel chapter 6. And I want to begin at verse, let's start at verse 1. I wanted to start at 8, but let's start at verse 1. And David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. That's an interesting number, same number that ran. There was afraid, and he said, all of you that's afraid, go home. Gideon's army, 30,000. That's an interesting number. Anyway, David arose, went with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah to bring up from thence the Ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, that dwell between the cherubims. They set the Ark of God upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, that was in Gibeah. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeah, accompanying the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark. And David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments made of fir wood, even on harps, and on psalteries, and on timbrels, and on coronets, and on cymbals. When they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen shook it. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and there he died. Wow. He died by the ark of God. David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah, called the name of the place Perez Uzzah unto this day. David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how shall the ark of the Lord come to me? So David would not remove the ark of the Lord unto him into the city of David, but David carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his house. So far the scripture. I want to focus in verse 10. David would not remove the ark of the Lord into the city of David, but David carried it aside. That's where the run on. We'll talk to you right there. David carried it aside. The ark, the glory, the manifestation of God, the promise of God, the presence of God, the cherubims around the throne of God have now turned aside. And David turned aside. Let's get some balance in the text for a second. Father, thank you for your word, your spirit, your grace this day. I pray in Jesus' name that you would grace us with illumination, clarification, insight, and above all, the grace to walk this out, that the word would become flesh and we'll bring your name glory through Christ. Amen. Let's pause for a second. This Ark of the Covenant, this box of acacia wood overlaid with gold, which represents humanity and divinity all at the same time in one deity, in one being. If it was all gold, it would have just been Kol Shama. It would have just been God. But it was wood. You should be like trees planted by the river of water. There were two wheels in the garden, two trees planted, two wheels present. Choose ye this day whom you're going to serve. God be God, serve him. Baal be God, serve him, Elijah said. And so wood represents humanity. Gold represents divinity. And so the Ark of the Covenant really was the tabernacle of Jesus. It represented Christ. God was never human, but Christ was. Or I should say Jehovah was not. Okay, are you with me? And so here we go. We got divinity and humanity with the glory coming up out of it. John 4, woman, if you knew who it was, y'all forgive me because I've been somewhere for 3 or 4 days and I just can't wrap my mind all around where I am. But he said, woman, if you knew who it was, I would have been in you a well of water springing up. And between the cherubims on the Ark of the Covenant came fire up out of them. And on the day of Pentecost, there was one place, one court, and tongues of fire came up out of them. Fascinating. And then you see fire is a purifier, and the Bible said in the book of Revelation, when John saw Jesus, that his feet were as polished brass. Fire had gotten to the feet, polished brass. Isn't it amazing that the fire will bless you, but the fire doesn't have to consume you until you yield all of your will, because Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego danced in the fire. So the fire is not always destructible. Sometimes the fire is your deliverance. I'm trying to teach my lesson, but I feel the preacher coming. And the fire is your deliverance. And so this box of wood overlaid with gold, and on the top of it was the mercy seat. And it was the first piece of furniture that God spoke to Moses to make. Make my throne first. Make my dwelling place first. Make mine first. Not the outward in, but the inward out. And so, well, that's too much. Okay, and so, can't unpack all of that. And so, this Ark of the Covenant was the visible manifestation that God was with us. But way back a book and a half earlier in 1 Samuel, we're up in 2 Samuel, but in 1 Samuel, Israel didn't worship like they ought. And when the Philistines came upon them, they were afraid. They ran and got the ark. The Bible says when they ran and got the ark, they were at Ebenezer. And when they ran and got the ark, they let out a yell because they were sure that God was with them, because heretofore the Lord hath fought for us. Heretofore the Lord hath been with us. Heretofore everything we've ever asked God to do, God did it. All the way up until now, God has always been our guide, our friend, our comforter, our keeper, our protector, our Jireh, our Elohim. He has been our Rapha. He has been our Nisi. He's been everything we've needed. And now we got an enemy coming, and they ran and got God. But it's difficult to run get God when you don't live like God say live. And so they ran and got God, and God wouldn't fight for them. And they lost the battle because they ran and got the glory unworthy. And when they ran and got the glory, they ran and they were used to just jumping up and preaching and people running, and they were used to singing, and people thought they was anointed because they had good voices. But they were used to the usher uniform and the choir robe. They were used to their religious ways, but they didn't pause and ask God, search me, Lord, and turn the light from heaven on my mind, my bad, on my soul. Mm-hmm. And if you find anything that shouldn't be. No, they were used to singing and preaching and dancing and then throwing tantrums before they got to the church parking lot. They were used to that. Talking with this one but won't speak to this one. They were used to that. And when they found out that there was a giant that opposed them, the Bible said that they got smote and they lost the battle, and the ark of the Lord was taken, and now there was a young girl and she was pregnant. Oh my God. And when Eli heard it, the priest heard it, he fell backwards, broke his neck. He was clear about one thing: it's better to be dead than to live a life without the glory of God. The Bible said Eli fell off the fence, broke his neck. His son Hophni and Phinehas, they died as well. The false priesthood died. Those that wouldn't be honorable priests died. Those that wouldn't adhere to God's word died. Those that wouldn't listen for a voice of prophecy, but they prophesied smooth sayings died. Those that just wouldn't keep their mouth off of the things of God, they wanted to judge what God wanted to have mercy on. Oh, God, help me, Holy Spirit. They wanted to be judges of what God wanted to have mercy on and continue to build and continue to restore and continue to renew and continue to revive and continue to replenish. But then you've got judges and judges and judges and judges. And oh my God, they forgot where the Lord brought them from, but they want to judge you on where God is taking you from. It's absolutely amazing. They died, and the Ark of the Covenant was stolen. And when the woman found out that the Ark of the Covenant was stolen, they said, be grateful because you've given birth to a man child. And she named the child Ichabod, which means false leader, false prophet, because the glory of the Lord, it technically means the glory of the Lord has departed. My Lord, can you hear that? Can you? No. Can you hear that? Don't hear it religiously. That you can give birth, my Lord, to an idea, give birth to a promise, give birth to a son, give birth to your hope. But the glory of God is departed, and God won't be there to bless your hope. God won't be there to bless your birth. God won't be there to bless your plan. You could try to live through that all you want to, but when Ichabod is written, God won't be there to bless your life. You'll have a form, but there'll be no power. And the glory of God was gone. The Philistines took it to Ashdod. God just dealt with Dagon, just cut his head, his hands off of after the second night of that foolishness. He just left their God as a stump. God just wiped out because he has no enemies. And then God, listen, was the Philistines, he smote the Philistines with emerods. Wow, emerods, another Old Testament name for hemorrhoids, and the Bible said they had great, you know, when God gives you a plague of hemorrhoids, that's not good. I didn't say if you have a natural, I said when God gives you a plague of hemorrhoids, that's not good, okay? Let's just move on, because that's a messy subject. Oh, Jesus, let's get out of that. Okay, and God smote them so much so until until, watch this, the Philistines follow the story. They put God on a new cart, okay? And they put him on a golden cart, and they put five mice on it, which represents, I mean, that's an Old Testament way of talking about a false fivefold ministry, five gold mice. Gold is supposed to be important, yeah, but that's five of them, yeah, five gold mice, okay, and a whole nother, and then aligned it with gold hemorrhoids or gold emeralds, okay, and put the Ark of the Covenant and just send him on his way. God has to make his own way, and he makes his own way back into the house of Abinadab, okay, what a thought, and he's there in Abinadab's house. For 20 years, God is there, and all of these people are in Jerusalem worshiping. 2000, 2020, 2001, 2002, 2003, 2004, 2005, 2006, 2007, 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012, 2013, 2014, 2015, 2016, 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020, 2021, 2022, 2023, 2024, 2025, 20 years, he's down in the house of Abinadab. And they even appoint Eleazar the priest to watch over him. Wow. To watch over him. Oh, okay. And Eleazar is the priest. I'm just trying to give you an introduction to the text. Do you mind? Because it's so hard to understand a text without understanding its context. Or else you'll take the text out of its context and make it say what it doesn't say. And try to make it mean what it doesn't mean, okay? And the Bible says, oh God, there's so much between 1 Samuel 6, 5, 6, and 7. There were 5 and 6, really. There's so much between that and 2 Samuel. I don't have time to get into all of that. But let's just know that down at Hebron, David receives his third anointing. Of course, God does things in threes. he does. Yeah. I mean, even Christ, we see him three different ways. We see him as a babe in a manger. We see Christ on the day he was baptized for us into the kingdom of God with John the Baptist, and God speaks over him. This is my beloved son, and the dove descends. And then we see him on the cross, okay, as the sacrifice. So David received three anointings. Yeah, John talks about it. John says, I write unto you as little children. I write unto you as young men. Then he writes unto you, the difference between technos and weos in the Greek, he says, I write unto you full grown men. So little children or teenagers, sophomores, sophos, moron, you're educated fools, sophos, educated moron. Okay, so little children, sophomores, grown men. So here we go. There's three spaces in your life that will be distinct. Just hear me. There will always be three stages of your life distinct. And so David receives his third anointing. Okay, his first anointing was when Samuel comes to the house. Okay, and David's out back, and oh God, and Jesse brings seven of his sons, and the anointing doesn't fall on them because they were Abinadab and Eliab. They were all tall. The Bible said that Saul was head and shoulders above every man. Saul was tall. I'm almost through the introduction. Give me two more minutes and we'll be right into the text, okay? And so the first anointing came after none of the seven sons would be anointed. Problem. Number one, first of all, they wasn't chosen, but all of Saul's firstborn sons outside of David, all of his first sons were tall and handsome. They looked like Saul. God was looking for a new man. He didn't want to anoint another Saul. Whew, boy, I don't know if y'all with me right now. I need some prayer. Willie, are you praying with me? Come on, prophet. God doesn't want to anoint another Saul when he's trying. Watch carefully. When he's trying to come back in, because right now Saul is a problem because Saul's not looking for the missing ark. Saul is not looking for the glory. Saul is looking for vain glory. Saul is looking to be king. Saul is looking for somebody to serve him. If you read carefully, Saul not only threw javelins at David, Saul tried to kill his own son Jonathan. When David missed the dinner, and when David was used to playing for Saul, and when David skipped dinner one night, David was just all about his business, and he knew that Saul wanted to kill him. David didn't show up. And the next night, when David didn't show up, the Bible said that Saul asked his son Jonathan, "Where is David? Why didn't he come to dinner tonight? Why didn't he come to dinner last night?" And Saul said, "Well, you know, Dad, I don't know, maybe David doing something." And Saul was angry with his own son, picked up the javelin and threw it at him. He would have killed his own son for his vanity. Saul is not to be anointed twice. Nano Shemasa. Saul is not to be anointed twice. And so David now has to receive his third anointing, because it took the second and the third to get the Saul in him out. That's a whole nother conversation. But that we're not after none of that right now. Okay, but hear what I'm saying. In order to serve God in the beauty of holiness with the splendor before the Ark of the Covenant in the earth, it's going to take more than a designer suit. It's going to take more than initials on your tennis shoes or on your dress. It's going to take more than fancy initials on your eyeglasses. It's going to take more than who's got the finest. It's going to take clean hands and a pure heart. It's going to take you. It's going to take you. You thought I said them. It's going to take you, my Lord, humbling yourself before the cross of Calvary. The cross is still the only way that we can obtain the blessings and the benefits of God. I know you want to tell me that you're saved, you've given your life to God. I get that. But have you, see, there's two crosses in your life, child of God. Yes, there are. There's the cross that Jesus died on, that both gave you redemption and propitiation. It redeemed you from the fall, and it spoke the propitiation before God. It removed his anger. But then Jesus says, "And if any man be my disciple, let him deny himself. Now you take up your cross. I begun a good work in you, but he that begun a good work in you, he's going before." Now you've got to finish the dying to self. You can't get into the kingdom of God. You can't get blessed right now. You can't get a new car and forget to finish dying. You can't get a new house and forget to finish dying. You can't be the bishop in town and have the largest anything and at the same time forget that your servants are loved by God as much as you are. You can't forget, my Lord, after God has blessed you and your husband and your children, you can't forget that God loves the people that are serving you. You can't forget it. You can't walk around the church throwing your weight around as if we're a potentate. We can't forget it. Listen, saints, let me help you with something. God wouldn't fight for Israel because they failed to worship. Oh, no. Listen carefully. Back up in the story. Just give me 10 seconds to address one little thing right here. I didn't want to preach this today. I just want to teach my lesson. Holy Ghost, help me. But remember when I told you that Israel went and got the Ark of the Covenant because they were at Ebenezer? When they got the Ark of the Covenant, the Bible said they let out a loud shout. There was a Shabbat. The word there is Shabbat. There was a loud praise. There was a loud, yeah, God is with us. We're going to whoop you Philistines. They gave God a loud praise. They gave him a praise so loud until the Philistines heard it. And the Bible said they got nervous, and the leader of the Philistines says, "Quit yourselves like men. Act like you're grown. Act like you're giants. act like you're going to whoop these little short people. We are giants. Now act like the praise was so loud until the enemy got nervous. Watch carefully. And I've heard many people say this. God help me from Zion today. If you praise God, you'll make your enemies nervous. If you praise God, you'll make your enemies nervous. Yeah, you will. And there's nothing wrong with that statement. It's true. If you praise God, you'll make your enemies nervous. But it don't make God show up. Read the text. They praised him. The Philistines got nervous. And God wouldn't fight for them. Just because you got a loud praise. Don't make God fight. Sham on this shit. It don't make God fight for you. For God is spirit. And they that worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Praise will make your enemies nervous, but it won't make God show up. It won't. God is looking. The Bible said, and such the Father seeketh after. So yes, everybody can dance. You can sit on the front row and hate and dance. You can be standing in the overflow and dance. But if you can't love the person beside you in the overflow, don't make any difference. Now about is faith, hope, and praise. Listen to the saints hollering at me. Pastor, no, that ain't the Bible. No, and love. And the greatest of all this is charity. Don't care how much you dance. Don't care how much you talk in tongues. Though I speak with tongues of men and angels and have not love. What? You can talk in unknown tongues without love? Paul said, yeah. 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 He said, and have not charity. Sounding brass and tinkling cymbal don't mean nothing. You can dance, you can talk in tongues, but if you can't love me, you can't love the brother. You can't love your sister-in-law. You don't love your co-worker. You don't love the preacher down the street. You talk about the one that's on TV. You call him a shyster. You can't get with your sister-in-law. Though you speak with tongues and men. The ark has turned aside. The glory has gone missing. Let's get back up into 2 Samuel. And the Bible said that in Hebron, the men perceived that David was God's choice. And they anointed him king. I'm trying to keep it together here. And they anointed David king. Yeah. And David went up. And when he went up, the city of David was occupied. So he fought the men and drove them out and called it the city of David. And Hyman heard of it. He was a rich ruler. And he sent David gold. And he sent David cedars of Lebanon. So David could build him a house. True enough, the anointing on your God, on your life, will, from your God, will have people when he's elevated you to bless you. God will give you some Hymans that will just send you gold. Send you cedars from Lebanon. And David built him a house. But he remembered the God that had anointed him in his father's house, his first anointing. He remembered the God that when he was running for his life, that anointed him again in the wilderness, his second anointing. And he remembered the God that had just anointed him the third time and made him king over all of his people. The Bible said over Jerusalem and Judah. The northern kingdom and the southern kingdom before they split. And God had anointed him to be king. Eroshamasit. Whew. And God had raised up men who blessed them. Yeah, and there'll be a hymen in your life. Yeah. So don't worry about being blessed. You don't have to seek it. Folk will seek you to bless you. Yes, they will. God won't let them sleep until they pour abundance in your life. And David built a house. And then he remembered, I'm living well. And the ark of God is down at Abinadab's house. Oh, no. And he went down there. And when he went down there, because everything was going right in his life, but he was wise enough to realize that the glory is missing. I said everything was going right. Most of us don't realize the glory is missing until the bottom falls out. But saints, it's good to know that you need God when you're on top. Whoo! It's good to know that you need God before COVID comes. Don't wait until you feel bad and you get a cough and your chest is hurting. Don't wait for that day. It's good to know that you need God now while everything is okay. It's good to know that you need God now while your grandchildren are doing okay. It's good to lay hands on them even though they may have to do some distance learning. But stop complaining if everybody is well, if nobody's on the ventilator, if nobody's on the respirator. Don't complain. Give God's name glory right here, right now. It's good to know that I'm living in a good house, and yet I need God's glory, because while I'm in the good house, I noticed that my children have not come to me and asked me any questions about a text that they read over in the book of Psalms. Oh, parents, don't try to keep up with the children on TikTok. What is the matter with this generation? The glory is missing. The parents are talking about TikTok. It's one thing for the children to come talk to the parents, but when you notice that your children haven't asked you anything about the glory of God, we need to know when your son is trying to convert his holy life to being a rapper. It's time now to ask God, where is the Ark of the Covenant? Where is the glory? When your daughter, my God, is trying to become a model and she's trying to express all of her vanity, and you are trying to tell me that it's signs of the culture. Don't worry about it, Pastor. Let the children express themselves. I don't want my children to express themselves in a place where darkness can overtake their life. I don't want everybody's name tattooed on my daughter's knee. I don't want everybody's name tattooed on my son's forehead and down his back. When he come downstairs to get a drink of water with no shirt on, I don't want his body all filled. I don't want the culture to overtake my house. Somebody needs to say, where is the glory of God? David was wise enough to realize the glory was gone and I'm living good days. He didn't have to wait until cancer struck and said, oh Lord, let your glory fall on me. He sought God's glory when he had gold and silver. What a revelation that I need God on my up days, not my down days. He sought God's glory in his up days. He was trying to be a tither in his up days. Oh, I'm concerned. I'm not going to fuss. I promise you I won't. But I'm concerned that the Holy Ghost will tell me to pray when my uncle is in the hospital. And the Holy Ghost will tell me to pray when I'm up for promotion. And the Holy Ghost will even tell me to pray when my sister is looking at divorce and I want she and her husband to stay together. But the Holy Ghost don't tell you to tithe. Nothing in you says I'm living my best life. The Holy Ghost don't tell you to give offerings, not $10 a month. I don't care what church you go to. You could be watching this in Georgia. Don't be a thief. The Bible calls them a thief. They take God's glory. They take God's favor. They take God's benefits. And they won't return them back. Oh, you can't come by my home and take my car and drive it till you get tired and never bring it back and feel like it's okay. I don't know how you feel like that's okay. I don't know how you feel like that's okay. Don't turn me off just yet, because I'm going to get to the text where the glory turned aside. As a matter of fact, let's go there now. And David inquired of the ark. Watch, watch, watch. Saints, we got to go real fast. Pray hard, saints. I can get this out before somebody turn me off. It doesn't matter what church you go to. This word was said in the Middle East. It just came all the way through Europe into America. This was a Middle East word. This was a Middle East. Middle East. Abraham gave tithe to Melchizedek over in Syria. So this was a Middle East word. Not here. Not local. Watch carefully. Well, watch carefully. And David said, I'm living in a beautiful home. And God's ark down there. And he went down to Abinadab's house. Yeah. And the Bible said that when he went down, they got the ark. Eleazar was the priest. Watch carefully. They remembered how God came in. How did he get there? Remember the Philistines? Darkness, sinners had begun to orchestrate some things. And so the only way they knew was what the culture had taught them. They didn't bother to study the word to find out. And so it's okay now to sing in the club on Friday and Saturday and then sing in the choir on Sunday what the culture has taught you is okay. And just because God has not brought penalty yet, we think that that's okay. Well, watch. God is missing and nobody cared. Let's watch. Let's watch. And the Bible says, whoa. Yeah. This is good. And they brought the house. They brought it out of the house of Abinadab. Verse 3. That was in Gibeah. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the cart. Uzzah was one of the guys who grew up around the ark. Read the text. See, some of you all are lightning fast. You're so smart. Stop it. I hear you. I hear you. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab. Yeah, we grew up around this. The ark has been in my house 20 years. I know God. I know God. I've been in church 20 years. I know God. Uzzah. I know God. Uzzah. The son of Abinadab. I know God. See, you all are getting it. Stop it. Stop it. I feel you. And Uzzah. I know God. Watch heaven. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeah, accompanying the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark, and David and all the house of Israel played. They were still happy before the Lord on all manner of instruments. Look at that. Of fir wood and harps, psalteries, tambourines, cornets, cymbals. And when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah, the one who knew God, the one who'd been in church 20 years, the one who was pastor's armor bearer, the one who was on the worship team, the one who was the chairman of the deacon board, the trustee board, been a musician all this time. My God, help me, Holy Ghost. Been head of the kitchen committee, been over the True Blue Club, been over the Willing Workers, been over the Helping Hand, been over the parking lot. Uzzah, I know God. I've been here 20 years. I know how things run. Oh, let's see. And when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God to hold it. Uzzah wanted to keep God where he had boxed him in at. And the Bible said that Nando Shabbat, somebody that had been around the ark for 20 years, fell dead because he had a form of godliness, but he denied the power. And he thought the gold meant more than the word, because God had already told them who to touch him and how to carry him. And he had been around the ark for 20 years and never read the Levitical order that the ark is not to be on a cart. The ark is to be on the shoulders of the commitments. The priests are to bear the ark. The priests are to carry God's glory, not put him on something and let somebody else do the work and pull him. Don't let a beast and an animal pull the glory. Don't let a thing pull the glory. Let the glory of the Lord rest on the kings and the priests of God. And Uzzah had been there for 20 years. And many Christians want to know, why did he have to die, Pastor? He was doing good. He had been with God for 20 years and never knew what he wanted. And when David saw that Uzzah had died, the Bible said the ark turned aside and he wouldn't take him no more, because he knew that something is wrong when COVID make us stay home from church. And the ark has to now not go up. God refuses to go any further with a people who don't know him. He refuses to go at the risk of somebody who is around him dying. He refuses to go any further with the people that don't care enough about him to study his word, just to see what he has already said. Watch the culture. They put him on a new cart. What did the Philistines do? Put him on a new cart. What did the culture do? Everything now is so cultural. I'm not knocking nobody to do it. Please, I'm going to say it, but I'm not knocking them. Because if it works for them, it works for them. But I don't do dark church. No, I'm not coming in and the lights is dim. And the spotlight is on the guitar player and the worship leader. And the rest of us is back here singing. I don't do dark church. Turn the lights up. Let me see who I'm worshiping with. I ain't painting the ceiling black like we in a club and the lights on the pulpit is strong. You act like you don't know what I'm saying. I don't do dark church. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. And so if I got to dim the lights in the church, let me see if I get this right. I got to dim the lights in the church for you to see God's glory. The glory, the dark. I'll understand. The culture is taking over. And we're experiencing a culture without the glory. Without the glory. We've got Uzzahs who've been around. Uzzah. Uzzah. Yeah. With the priest right there in his house, Eleazar. Uzzah. Right around the priest, and don't understand what the glory is. And oh God. And David was angry because he said, God, we're trying to do the right thing. God, we're trying to do the right thing. The right thing is not a substitute for the word. But somebody should tweet that. The right thing is no substitute for truth. And my Lord, so David would not remove the ark of the Lord unto him into the city of David. The ark can't go with me. God's glory won't go with me. And now I'm afraid to touch it, because folks that have been playing with it for the last 20 years suddenly get a feel of it don't take all of that. Or I'm looking for something different. Or I don't understand the times. Some of my colleagues, God bless them, are talking foolishly. If we get 30 or 40 pastors and go out in the streets and go to praying and go to prophesying, what? Did God ask Moses to get 30 or 40 Levites to go out in the street? He said the death angel coming through. Now you better tell everybody to put the blood over their doorposts and stay in the house. Because one fellowship has already lost 30 or 40 bishops to COVID. He said, I didn't tell y'all to do that. I told you, when you see the death angel, put the blood over your doorpost. And don't you all keep tagging and co-signing for folks. And I mean this. Don't keep tagging and co-signing folks that do contrary to what the word says. Don't keep following the culture. And you can tell who does that, because it's always younger people that don't have experience with God. There comes a time, saints, I'm trying to lead you to a place of peace. You say what you want. There comes a time where wisdom needs to speak. And I'm going to say to you what a brother said to me that made me angry. I've read the text. Have you? No, I don't boast to know it all. I'm trying to lead you into something right here. I need you to see that God's choice, David, who God sent Samuel to anoint, and Samuel asked Jesse, have you got any more sons? God had chosen none of these. God's choice. Listen to this. God's choice couldn't go any further. God's choice. I didn't say wouldn't. Couldn't go any further, because they hadn't got the word right. And God said, that's not how I want to go. I'm not even going to tell you. I already left it there. If you want to know how I want to go, all you got to do is read what I said. I already told you in Leviticus, and I already told you over in Exodus how to carry me. I already told you. You don't need a new word. You need to do what it is I say. He said that to John on the Isle of Patmos, you know. I told you I've been all over the place. Y'all praying for me? Look at there. My time is going away. I need you to hear this. Pastor, have I gotten anybody's attention? Is anybody still online? I can't hear nobody. Are y'all still here? Well, he said that over in the book of Revelation. God is the only one of us. I certainly can't. And I'm not going to believe you if you say that you can. I certainly can't boast on my past. God is the only one that boasts on his past. He told John on the Isle of Patmos, he said, John, I am Alpha. I'm the one who started all this. I look back at my history and I like it. I'm Alpha and I'm Omega. Whew. You know, God, you listen, let me help you something. God will boast on his past. Do you hear what I'm saying? Listen, we're getting ready to commune. And Paul says over in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he said, I wasn't up in the upper room when Jesus had fellowship with the brother. He said, and I wasn't with the other apostles. Paul said, nobody taught me this. Paul said, for I have received of the Lord. Watch this. I have received of the Lord the same night God showed me his past. The same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke the bread. He said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. For as often as you do it, you show forth my death till I come. And likewise, Paul was caught up. He said he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it. He said, now drink ye all of it. This is the new covenant. This is the new covenant. This will tie the old and the new. You'll have the Old Testament, the New Testament, and they'll become one book. This makes one. God, I love you. God will boast on his past. He said, prove me. Pull up my record. Check what I've done. See if I won't open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing you've not room to receive. And I'll even rebuke the devil. Check my record. Look what I've done. God will boast on his past. None of us can. Oh God, we was wretched undone. But thanks be to God, we're delivered. And David now had to turn aside. Let me get to where I can pull out this text and stop right here, because I know I'm not going to finish. And David can't go any further. Why? Because the glory is missing. Wow. So, are you with me? Whew. Bless his holy name forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. The glory is missing. The glory is missing. And David went back and searched the scriptures. The Bible says in the next verse that the ark of God was down at Obed-Edom's house for 3 months. 3 months. It took him 3 months to learn how to fix this. How long have we been in the house from COVID? Let me ask a question. While we was in the house, how many of us sought the glory? It's taken almost 3 months to just get quiet. Did we seek why the ark won't go any further? Have we sought why? Why the number one Christian nation on the planet got a heathen for a president? Have we sought why? Have we sought why our nation has to say publicly, my life matters? Please don't kill me. I'm important. Can you not shoot my son in the street? Will you not put your knee on the neck of my brother? How do you put your knee on him and put your hands by your side and hear a grown man say, mama? Have we sought why God has to turn aside? Could it be we're bringing him up wrong? And David carried it aside. Now was not the time to be angry with your husband and fight. It's not the time to argue with your parents. It's not the time to fight with your children. It's not the time to disconnect from your sister and won't return her Facebook. She just wants to say hi. It's not the time to ignore your brother who's incarcerated. Write him. Take his call when he calls. It's not the time, for the ark has turned aside. Pastor, why are you saying, what church are you going to now? What building are you in? For the ark has turned aside, and the people don't care. I have pastors who are saying to me, hey, right, I like this at home thing. I already told my church that when COVID is lifted, we're going to worship on Sunday, but we're going to stay online during the week. The ark has turned aside. How do you plan to not come together? I told you, I prefaced this in the beginning, that this is not going to be so good, because if you was looking for a new car, a new house, the ark, the glory of God turned aside. And now we're not laying hands on the sick. And now we're not having prayer meetings. And David tried to bring it up and the ark has turned aside. We sit around bored and our Bible is over there on the table. And we sit here bored. I know what I'll do. I'm going to binge watch Netflix. And the ark has turned aside. We are the same people that God healed of cancer. We're the same people that God has paid our mortgage. And our Bible is over there and we're sitting looking, wondering what could we do with our day. I'm bored. I'll be glad when we could get out the house. And the ark has turned aside. And the ark has turned aside. 150,000 people have died. And the president says, maybe if you drink some bleach, maybe that'll kill what's going on the inside. And the ark has turned aside. And the preachers are saying, let's stay online. I like it. It's better for my people. And the ark has turned aside. And David couldn't take the ark up any further. Pastor, you got to get us out of this phone. Get the ark. Take it up so we can dance. You really want that? We could do that. Yeah, I could close with that. You really want that? Let's go get the ark. Let's see what happens next. And so David goes back. And he goes and gets the Ark of the Covenant. But this time he got it right. And David don't have on his king outfit. He ain't head honcho no more. Now, the one that God chose got on a priestly outfit. Yeah, in order to do business with God, you got to change your clothes. No. Not physically, but you got to change your mindset. You can't be the one to strut in your $5,000 suit. No. You got to be the leader of the worship team. My God, you can't stay in the office while praise and worship going on. You got to be out there with the people. David went and he got the ark. And this time, after 3 months, he got it right. And when he brought it up, watch carefully, David prepared to bring it up. See, because it wasn't random. Where did he turn aside at? You got to ask the question. When he got to the threshing floor, God wouldn't go any further, meaning until you learn sacrifice, mando sheba sata, until you learn what it takes for me, until you're willing to give up what's yours to obtain what's mine, until you're willing to lose your life and take my life, until you're willing to make a public display that the gift I gave you is worth the gifts you'll give me. He turned aside. The place where they was at the threshing floor, where you make your sacrifices, where you bring your offerings. And David said, not only will I make threshing for sacrifices at the threshing floor, but David said, God, is that what you want? You want a sacrifice out of me? You've spared my life. You didn't let Goliath kill me. You didn't let his four brothers kill me. You didn't let the Philistines kill me. You didn't let Saul kill me. You kept me all this time. The Bible said that David said sacrifice. He didn't say it with his mouth. He said it with his actions. Every six paces, every six steps. Now where they were at the threshing floor down there and all the way up to the top of Jerusalem was only 8 miles. But yet it was 8 miles. How far is 8 miles from my house to the church, or maybe here down to the wharf, or how maybe you go from here halfway to Silver Spring, 8 miles from your house? Can you imagine for the next 8 miles, every six steps You're cutting lambs' necks and bullocks, and that y'all playing with music and dancing, saying, I'm sacrificing unto God. Watch where they lost the ark. The ark wouldn't go any further than the threshing floor. And David turned aside right there, because Uzzah died, because he didn't know how, having been around the glory all this time, he didn't know how to sacrifice, he didn't know how to worship, he didn't know how to carry the gold of God, the ark of the covenant, he didn't know how to be a priest. He had been around the ark and didn't know how to be a priest. He had been around the anointing and didn't know how to be a priest. He had been around the glory and didn't know how to be a priest. And when David studied it, when he got the word, he didn't have to get the feeling, because the word will stand all by itself. When David got the word right, he said, come on, y'all. Now, you don't get enough sacrifices for every six steps unless you prepare to be an offering. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure, holy, tried, true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sacrifice to you. And David, every six steps, he offered unto God, and they had a ball. And watch, he wasn't poor. They made all those offerings for 8 miles. And then when he got the ark to the city of David, up on top of Zion, the Bible says he gave everybody bread and wine. Not a little bit, a good piece of bread. Oh, they had a banquet. They said, you know what? If we're going to celebrate anything, we celebrate birthdays, and we celebrate anniversaries, and we celebrate good things. But if we're going to have a feast, it's going to be because God is finally back with us. Are we preparing for the day in the earth where God is finally back with us? Can you imagine, my Lord, when we come back together, the first person that comes up in that door with cancer get healed, we ought to have a banquet. Everybody ought to cook. My Lord, 5 or 10 turkeys and 8 or 10 chickens. We ought to have a celebration. Why? Because the glory is finally back with us. And they celebrated because the glory was back with them. Are you prepared for the day where COVID lifts and we get back to the church and the glory finally rests with us? No more church as usual. No more business as usual. Boy, I don't know if this is even making sense to anybody. Just love. Even if they don't love you back, love. God not going to judge me for what you do. God going to judge me for what I do. So I'm going to love you. And not what you think of me that counts. What you think of me don't mean a hill of beans. I had to teach myself that. Because if you're not careful, what folks think about you will steal all of your joy. And I had to realize, God, you're going to judge me for how I love them. And Jesus was on the cross and looked at the men who nailed him and said, Father, forgive them. Oh, it's going to take a lot to be like Jesus, for they know not what they do. My time is slipping away. We got to have communion. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying? That you got a chance right where you are to usher God's glory into your private universe. You got a chance. I have a chance. We have a chance. And if we do it individually, then corporately will be so easy. I feel the weight of God's glory, like we've tapped into something. If you told me to get up out of this chair right now, I don't think I could stand. Father, I pray that you share this glory that I feel with all of those who are just here to worship you with me. And David turned aside. The ark has turned aside because we've got too many people, Eleazars, priests of the old order. And we need some Abners. There was an Eleazar and an Abner, an old order priest and a new, David appointed Abner. Okay, that's a whole nother story in teaching, and I don't have time to unpack that right now, because you'll see later on that when trials came, that Abner chose the old order, and he chose Saul's way, and David, and Eleazar chose Saul's way, and Abner chose David's way. You had Saul, David, Adam, Jesus, Eleazar, Abner. There's always two men in the Bible, two trees in the garden. There's always two. When you would do good, evil is present. Paul talked about it. There's always two. There's always two. There's two nations in you, Rebecca. My Lord. And two nations in you are trying to come out. My God. It's always two. And there was two priests, an old order and a new order. Oh, one more thing. You know who was missing here? The devil. The devil. God was present. But you don't see no signs of that. You know, the devil will tell you don't worship. Please stop the devil. Unread, unlearned, unprayerful, unfasted, unrenewed minds is what you're fighting with. Satan is defeated. Jesus said, I got the keys of death and hell. You know, the devil will try to kill you. Jesus said, I got the keys. So can we settle that? Ooh, that's kind of sharp, Pastor. Yes. Why are you still playing with the devil? You keep calling him, he'll show up. The devil is like an old boyfriend. He ain't studying you. But I tell you what, you keep calling him, he's going to say, oh, you know what? I do remember her. She was a nice gal. Yeah, I wonder what she doing. I wonder, did she get married yet? Yeah, I remember her. No. There was flesh trying to bring spirit up the way that spirit didn't want to be handled. God caused David to turn aside. And the ark has turned aside. I'm praying about something right now, because I had a major prophet in the earth call me yesterday. No, not somebody who prophesies. A major prophet. You've seen him on every network. No, not a preacher. You've seen him. It's not somebody that you would know. No. You would know him, but you a major prophet. And we were talking. And he said, right, where are you at in God? And I said, I'm at the point where God has turned aside. And he said, when you said it to me, everything in my body shook in my being. Everything in me that was spirit shook. He said, I'm pleading with you as a prophet. That's the word to the nations, to the planet. Write the book. He said, I'm pleading with you, write the book. That the glory of God has turned aside. He said, because nobody wants to speak truth. We want to speak truth to power, but we don't want to speak truth to the body of Christ. Because the body just wants to keep dancing. No, he pleaded with me. He says, write the book. Please write it. I told him, I'll think about it. Right now, my head's not in writing. Right now, my head's just in seeking. David is a clear picture of how we could do better. All David had to do was go and read the text. And when he read the text, then he says, we got it right. And when they got it right, saints, do you know when you get it right? When you get it right, I have a dish that I enjoy. I won't say what it is because I don't want you to judge my wife, because that's going to be a problem for me. But and I asked my wife to cook. And I said, you know, I noticed that you hadn't made such and such and such in a while. And she said, I know, because every time that I've tried it, it didn't turn out as my absolute best. And I didn't want to give you what wasn't my best, so I avoided it because I was afraid. And then she tried again, and she got it right, and she was so happy. See, when you get it right, you just have joy unspeakable. And David got it right, and watch. Woo, God, this will make, Elder D, this is going to make you shout, daughter. And when you get it right, God will let you handle him. That's the space that somebody could have jumped up and started running. Because when David got it right, God let him pick the ark up. And God went everywhere that he wanted to take him. And David took the ark of the covenant and he took him up to Zion. And they were celebrating. When you get it right, God will let you handle him. Isn't that what John said? That which our eyes have seen and our hands have handled. We've touched him. We've beheld him. We've handled the glory of God. Oh God, I love you so much. When you get it right, God will let you handle the things of the glory of God. You can handle his glory. You can handle it because he can trust you. Because he can trust you. The only reason you do it is because you got the word right in you. You got the balance of his word. We got to stop. I got to pray. Are you blessed yet? Have you recommitted some of your time yet? Have you recommitted your study space yet? Have you recommitted your ways yet? Have you noticed, honestly, we're the saints that'll be honest and say, you know, Pastor, truthfully, for the last 9-12 months, it feels like God has turned his side. I don't feel forsaken. I just don't feel like he's releasing his absolute best, his total best. I'm blessed. God knows I am. But it feels like he's turned aside just to see what I'll do now. Wow. 20 years down in Abinadab's house, 3 months over here in Obed-Edom. We trying to move him, but he got to turn aside until we get the word right. And when we get the word right, then we'll see miracles, signs, wonders. We'll see cancer disappear, tumors, lumps, fibroids. We will see legs grow. My wife has a friend. She has a limp. And one leg is shorter than the other. I want to throw her in a chair so bad and hold her feet and watch the one leg just come back out to the other. I just know that God is a healer. I know that God is a healer. I know that cataracts can disappear. Come on, saints, let's get the word right. When we fall in love with God's word again. When we fall in love. Am I talking good? Is anybody getting it? How many of you want to see those kind of miracles with me? I mean, undeniable, visible manifestations that God is a healer. Yeah. Undeniable. Yeah. Merciful Father, thank you for today. Oh, God, I'm running out of time, but I'm certainly not out of word. Lord, I feel like even though you're with us, you're omnipresent. I get it. But I just feel like your absolute total manifestations are not happening as you would desire. So today we pray, bend this will to conform to yours. Not my will, but thy will be done. Cause us to be transformed from being hearers to being doers. I don't want to be Uzzah. In the house with the glory for 20 years and don't know how you desire to go forward. So Lord, give us the Urim and the Thummim. Grant us lights and illumination. Cause us to see the perfection of your anointing, your plan, your will, your love for us. If there's any direction to any executive on this line, speak to their minds about decisions that must be made on the, I feel like praying for that. Holy Ghost, thank you. That there's some executive decisions that need to be made this week. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done. That's my prayer. Father, I pray that if there's any sick among us, that you heal right now. You were wounded. Your history is good, God. You were wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. Your peace was on us. Well, our peace was on you, and with your stripes we're healed. We thank you. No, we really do thank you. Prepare us, God, to bring your glory in a way, my Lord, that you will allow us to handle you. And we say thank you. Now, God, as we prepare our hearts, we pray if there's anybody that has any sin on their life today. God, if I've said a word, did a deed, thought a thought, had a desire that wasn't like you, wash me again. Put me under the fountain of blood. There is a fountain that's filled with blood and it's drawn from your vein. And all of us can plunge beneath that flood and lose all of our guilt and stain. So wash me again before we commune. And if there's anybody, Lord, on our platforms that's saying, wash me, would you wash them? Would you help us? Would you bless us? Would you keep us? God, turn not away from us, but teach us, Lord, how to handle spiritual things so that the world will know that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, what a lesson. I'm still stuck. I've been stuck for a while. I've been stuck. I am stuck. I'm still stuck. And thank God. That her name is Malia Saints. She here pastor preaching, so she thinks that I'm talking to her. So she's supposed to preach. She's supposed to talk back. So listen, I'd rather the babies be praising Jesus. So if you hear the baby, I know some of you saying, I hear the baby in the background. Yeah, because she hear her papa. And when you know, the funniest thing is she do what papa do. If I fall asleep on the sofa, I don't know how she can tell I'm asleep upstairs, but she'll go get her grandma's hand and bring it to the top of the steps and go, shh. Because I guess she perceives I'm downstairs sleeping. Maybe she peeped or something. I certainly couldn't have been snoring. Who does that? But she tells her grandma, shh, because I'm quiet. And then when I get loud, then she thinks it's time to preach. And so she's doing her thing, and her grandma is going ballistic because she's trying to get quiet because of communion. That's all right, but maybe she heard me say, bring the Lord up with shouting and singing and dancing. Listen, saints, you're about to experience miracles, signs, and wonders. Now ain't time to be quiet. Listen, we finally are at the place where we're getting it right. We're finally at the place where we can reveal the secrets of our heart. I can just say, God, okay, I ain't hiding this from you. You know I got that right there. You know I think that right there. You know I want that right there. You know I feel a certain kind of way right there. It's right there, Jesus. Somebody take your finger. Let me see. Everybody hold your finger up right in front of your camera. Let me see it. Right in front of it. You got it? Now point and just say, it's right there, Jesus. You know where it is. You know what I'm talking about, too. Lord, you know what I'm talking about. Get that right there so I can bring your glory up. I don't want you to turn aside out my life. I felt that. Somebody said, Lord, it's right there. I don't want you to turn aside anymore. David had to turn aside. Listen, saints, David is the same guy that was fighting giants. But when it came to moving God, it broke him down. If God's glory don't break you down, I don't know. As for me and my house, we're going to be praying over here. We're going to be praying. Because I know my wife needed to repent, because she was cutting the chicken up the other day, and she had the knife that was this long, and I walked in and she just looked at me. I said, Father, in Jesus' name, don't let her stab me. She'd been cooped up in the house with me for 5 months. And then she was sleeping. I walked in the bedroom and one of them horror movies on TV, not horror movies, one of them Lifetime movies where the guy was choking the wife. And I said, what would happen if I just jump on the top of the bed and choke her? Just da-da-da-da-da-da. Listen, when you're in the house, your patience gets tried. That's all I'm saying. We all human. We all in the same boat. Now, y'all, you'll tell the truth. Y'all ain't wanna. Sophia, did you want to the name? Didn't you? I know you. Get your communion. We need some communion after that, don't we? But when she looked at me, the knife was saints. It looked like it kept. The longer she looked at me, it looked like the knife kept getting longer. It just looked like it was that long. The knife. I'm like, Lord, if she just waved that at me, I might get cut. Lord Jesus, don't let her wave it. But she finished with the chicken. Amen. The chicken was good too. Praise the Lord. I love you. I'm trying to just put a little smile on your face to let you know the Lord is with you. 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 You know what I hear? Wife, you know what I hear? I keep hearing Jocelyn's song back in my head. You played that earlier. Would you play that for me? I keep hearing that right now. I declare. You know, after we get it right, we can declare. See, at first we got it wrong. But now that we got it right, the covenant of David lets me speak. See, the covenant of Abraham gave me the land. The covenant of David lets me proclaim over it. Yes, yeah, so now I'm going to declare some things. Yeah, that's the covenant of David. I declare. Yeah, yeah. I've been loosed from the ways of Eleazar. Now I follow the priesthood of Abner and David. Yeah, all of that's broken off of me. All of the religious ways, all of my doubt, all of my fear. Come on, get your communion. We're going to prepare. Let's do this. Yeah, that you have the right to do that now. You have the right. You have the right. Lord Jesus. Are you still watching me? Oh God. I was talking to my son because he was watching me on YouTube, and I'm talking to him, and he didn't know I was talking to him because he was watching us on YouTube, wasn't he? I declare all things lost. Sister Jocelyn, that what you said? I declare all things lost. I declare. Because I've been to the text. I got it right. Can you hear that? I got it right. Come here, Miss Gucci. She's just standing, waiting. She's standing, waiting for her entrance. Come here, sit by Papa. Come here. We're gonna do communion. We had some technical difficulties. Are you prepared? Do you have the body and the blood of the Lord? Are you ready? And he took the bread and he blessed it. And when he gave thanks, Jocelyn sang until she fell out in the spirit. Jocelyn, did you fall out? Y'all wake Jocelyn back up. She sang and she fell out. She up now? She up now. My wife said, Jocelyn, she said, you back up again. Amen. I'm so thankful. And in a very real sense, I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful for his precious blood. You have your bread. You have your family. Good. Now let us prepare to commune together. And on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke the bread and he said, take, eat, this is my body. It's broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Come on, let's eat together. All the right doors. Likewise, took the cup. I feel healing for somebody right now. when you commune, I speak to that infirmity and it's going to be gone. And when he'd given thanks, he said, drink ye all of it, for this is the cup of the New Testament. Let us drink together. Amen. Father, I thank you. I don't know whose body you just healed, but I thank you for the healing in Jesus' name. For the healing in Jesus' name. For the healing in Jesus' name. And it's so. Come on, all of the people of God should agree and say amen.
Amen.
Thank God. Whew. I love you. Today has been a wonderful day. Even though God stepped all over my toes, my ankles, my knees, but I thank God for his grace. Let's worship in our giving, saints. Will you do that? Let's worship. Let's worship. Let's worship. The Lord has been generous to us. Let's just let him know we appreciate his generosity. You know, this is so weird. I'm almost embarrassed to say it. Sow your tithe, sow your offerings. I want four categories in the offering today, only because I heard the Lord say the tithe and offerings, that's an automatic. And then we have always our 15 envelopes. And for our new people, say, why do y'all keep saying envelopes? It's our custom in our house. If we was in church, we'd give out 15 envelopes. People would just take them because we believe that we're one body and somebody can't sow today. So we're sowing a seed, kind of like in what we call a general pot, that whoever needs a breakthrough and a miracle this week, a seed has been sown for them. And so they could say, Lord, this wasn't my week. I didn't have it. But I tell you what, I thank you for my brothers and sisters who sowed for me. And we don't do it just to be seen. We do it with purpose. So I want you to take my 15 envelopes. And I heard that three of you ought to sow a seed of $1,000 a day. And I don't know why. And 1,000 ain't a lucky number. And I just heard that. And I think that I hear the Lord pretty good. And I believe. And I don't know who you are. And there are three of you that I heard it. And I didn't say 50 people sow it. Take those of you that's going to take my envelope, my 15 envelopes, sow those seeds. But there are three people that's going to sow a seed of $1,000. I'm not waiting to find out who you are. You know who you are. It hit your spirit. It hit the bottom of your spirit. And I know you're there. And watch and see what the Lord does for you. See, David never told the people, I ran and read the Bible. And he just went and got it right. All I'm telling you is I heard the voice of the Lord. That's what he said. And I'm saying what he said. And that's the end of my job. My job is just to give you the word. I love you. Thank you. But did that text just resonate in you? And David turned aside. David, you mean you're bringing the glory up and God won't let you even bring the glory? No, because you didn't have it right. I don't care whether you can play B flat or F sharp. I don't care what you play. Doesn't matter. You have to get it right. I don't care what kind of voice you have. You can sing almost as good as me, and Sister Jocelyn, she don't quite sing as good as me. I'm, you know, she getting it. I'm the best one. But it doesn't matter until you get it right. Let's study and show ourselves approved. Sow your seeds. Y'all get my envelopes? Wife, did they get my envelopes? Not yet. Y'all didn't get my 15 envelopes? Oh, Lord. I got one person that got my envelopes. Okay. I still have 14 envelopes. I had to do this every first Sunday. I don't think so. Come, I know you better than that. I do. I do. Yeah. Churchill, how you doing this morning, sir? You good? What do you say, wife? Oh, they did? Somebody said this on the seat of $1,000. Bless you. There's two more of you. I just heard three. That's what I know. I heard. I know what I heard. I know what I heard. My time is up. I love you. Look at the clock. We got to go. You're going to have a beautiful day today. It's going to be wonderful. The kingdom of God is at hand. Tuesday, I'm doing a seminar. It's noon or 11? Tuesday. Tuesday, I'll be doing a mental health seminar. Come on, join me. Huh? Oh, and we're feeding too. Yes, that's important. And we're feeding on Tuesday as well, because so many people, their doors have closed that we're feeding, and many of them had the same source. We have a different source, and our source is still allowing us to feed on Tuesday. So we'll still be feeding. I don't remember how many we fed last week, but it was a lot of people, and we thank God. So we got, you know, just multiple things happening. And then on Wednesday, the seminar that I spoke to you about, with my wife and Lady McKissick and Lady Susie Owens and Lady Omarosa. Good. So that's going to be Wednesday. I love you. Check your emails. I'm sure you'll get all of this. And sow your seed. Sow your seed. I got, 12 envelopes left? Ooh, that's not fair. Anyway, y'all grab the envelopes. Sow that. And the other two, I'll look for you. God bless. I love you. Good day.